Glory be to God. Welcome to D. Weaver Art here on YouTube. I give glory and praise to God that you choose to watch this channel. Today I'd like to share with you about edges. What are edges and how do they work for me as an artist? Now, if you're new to the D. Weaver Art channel, I urge you to subscribe. Also, don't forget to hit the notification bell. By doing so, you will receive instant alerts on new content and material. Now, with that being said, let's talk about edges. Now, what are edges? D, what do you mean, edges? Edges are those points in your, those areas in your painting in which there's a value or slight difference or strong difference in the value contrast. Or when every time you put down a paintbrush stroke, it creates an edge. The edge is definitely going to be not the end of an object or that which separates the foreground from the background of an object and so forth. That edge is the very edge what we use. There's no such thing in reality as line. So, but when we draw things, we create a line as a demarcation, a shift in the value. Now, let's say in my background, if you can see, there's a table. Then there's the backdrop. The backdrop is black. You see the laptop in the background is creating the edge. And that edge there is a sharp edge. It's a very hard edge. It's an abrupt shift in value of color. What is value? If you're going to be able to create edges, you have to understand what values are. Values are the lightness and darkness of a color. No matter what that color is, it's either middle value, low value, or high value. High value meaning the lightest, low value meaning the darkest, and the middle value is in between. Every time you put down a brush stroke, it naturally creates an edge. And you as an artist must understand how to work those edges to your advantage. As an artist, when you have a proper understanding of what edges are, that enables you to be able to move the viewer's eye in and around your painting to the center of interest. D, what do you mean by center of interest? I'm glad you asked me. The center of interest is that is the reason why you paint the thing. That which moved you, that which had got your attention, that which is the center of interest, that you want to show the viewer what you saw, and you paint it in such a way that they can't help but to see it. But you don't paint everything in the entire, on the entire canvas, like, here, look at me, I'm over here. No, you want to center that attention in one particular spot. And the way you do that as an artist to get that viewer to center in on that spot is to soften out and use a variety of different types of edges to your advantage. And in this video, I want to show you how you can do that. There are four different types of edges. There are hard edges, soft edges, lost edges, and broken edges. Let's start with hard edges. Now, D, what is a hard edge? That hard edge is going to be a shift of, not a subtle, but an abrupt shift in value where, in other words, you got a contrast in the value and there's no transition in between the values. I mean, it's light and day, light and dark. Hey, it's a big difference and it's obvious and it creates a hard edge. It's an abrupt shift in the value, not a subtle shift, but an abrupt shift in the value. Those are hard edges. So now let's move on to soft edges. What are soft edges? Those are those edges that have a slight similar value range or values, but they're not completely exact the same, but it's just enough to make it soft. That's what's called a soft edge. That's called a soft edge, and you want to use them to your advantage. When you use these soft edges, it gives you, the viewer, a sense of an illusion of depth. It causes the thing that you use it, if you use it right and use it on the right things that you want not to be your particular center of interest, then you use those soft edges. Get the values as close, but not exactly, to what the other, the edge that you just put down. So if you got a, you can turn hard edges to soft edges by mixing up color that's similar between the two that touch, and that way you can soften those edges. When you do that, it creates a sense of atmosphere and mood. So as an artist, if you know how to mix your colors and understand value, every time you put down that brush stroke, remember you're creating an edge. So pay very close attention to what you're doing and have a proper understanding how to use those edges to your advantage. After all, you want to move that viewer's eyes to the center of interest. And when you get to the center of interest, your center of interest is going to have the most saturated of color and the harder edges. Edges are going to be hard around it because it's going to be that part that's going to pop out and actually come forward to the viewer. Excuse me. It's actually going to come forward to the vision of the viewer. It's actually going to, instead of recede into the distance, which soft edges will do, hard edges will make those things come forward. Also, with the use of saturated color, you're going to be able to grab that viewer's attention to your focal point or your center of interest. That could be the eyes, the clothing, the background, the foreground, wherever you want to show that center of interest. You as an artist have that right to create it the way you want it to be. But those are the principles that if you want your artwork to not look flat, then I advise you, with the teaching I'm giving you, to use soft edges and use a combination of hard and soft edges. But do know this, if you want things to be more three-dimensional and more receding back and have a sense of depth, then I advise you use quite a bit of soft edges in your painting. But only select hard edges for the areas that you want to emphasize on or show focal point to when you have a hard edge. Now, what are the lost edges? Lost edges are just exactly what it is. It's an edge that is completely gone. There is no sense of beginning or ending on that edge. It's completely vanished, as if it don't even exist. You can also give a sense of mood and also mystery, and also creates an aesthetic quality where the viewer begins to try to fill in the blanks, per se. It gives the painting a sense of mystery. And you as an artist have that when you understand how to use values and create certain types of edges in the way you, what you're trying to do is create that story or create a mood for that viewer, and also create some mystery in that. Now, how do lost edges occur? When you have values that are similar, not similar, I should say, exactly the same, where it could be a different color, but the exact value. And the values, actually your brain can, when you squint, you only see the darks. You see things, just only the main shapes that you see. But when you create those lost edges, when you open your eye, you see all the edges to some extent. Not all, every ledge, but most of the edges you see. But when you squint your eye, you tend to lose those areas where they become soft, and it kind of merges in with other shapes or other points of objects in your background or foreground or whatever you may be painting. So remember, when you put down a brush stroke, you create an edge. So if you mix paint that's exactly the same as the edge is, and the exact same value, you're going to actually lose that edge. The edge is going to completely, subtly disappear. It's as if you don't see the beginning or the end of it, it's just completely gone. So that is what a lost edge is. And broken edge, this is a broken edge. When you take a paintbrush, a little bit of paint, it's a dry brush technique where you go over a dry spot of paint, just barely touching the canvas, and it creates these broken points of color, different areas around the edge, and it's like fragments of color that's released into the background or off the object. It gives a more different aesthetic and quality to your paintings. And as to me, it's very, I like it. Those are called broken edges. So now I want to share with you guys how colors can have value, a range of value within one color itself. Each color, anytime you put down a color, there's a value to that color, and there's a range of values that can be created depending on how much of any color you put, but particularly black and white. Anytime you add white to a color, you tint the color. Anytime you add black to a color, you shade the color. Anytime you add gray or the mixture of both white and black to a color, you create a tone of values. So in the middle there, where it's number five, you see if you go all the way from left to the right, it produces a pure royal blue. But then if you add white to that royal blue, it creates a sky blue. Or if you add black to that blue, it creates a darker blue, almost like a navy blue if you keep going adding black to it. So that happens with any color. I'm going to show you another example of another color, how this is done the same exact way. So let's say, for instance, you don't have, the color is black and white, which I'm going to get to that. I'm kind of getting ahead of myself, but you mix black and white, you get what? Gray. So within that range, there's a range of grays in between. Same thing with any color you mix. Anytime you add gray, black, or white, you're going to give a different range of values for with that color. So that's what I wanted to share with you guys in this blue here, this blue color chart. So at the top, you got the chroma is weak, all the way to chroma being strong. So from left, it's weak, and to the right, it's stronger. The chroma gets stronger. Chroma means the saturation or the pureness of the color. Anytime you add a color to another color to a pure color, it's going to desaturate or bring the color down, or excuse me, bring the chroma down or weaken the chroma. So that's what happens automatically when we mix different colors and we add white to a color or black to a color. We either increase the value, we intensify that value, or decrease the value. Value is the lightness and darkness of a color. Okay, now I have in front of you guys a color chart for the color red. So just like the color blue, you have a gray scale with a mixture of black and white. You get those gray values. So number five is like that middle tone, the tone version. And so if you go from left to the right, the colors get more stronger in saturation or strong in chroma. Chroma, once again, is the pureness of a color. In other words, color that hadn't been mixed with another color, the actual color itself. Now, you also see your dark value, middle value, and light value. In a moment, I'm going to show you a photo or a picture of a image that's in high scale, and then there's a low scale, or low key and high key. High key meaning that the colors are, the values are much brighter, much more lighter in value. Then low key, meaning that your colors are more lower in value, which means they're darker. Here is the gray scale, or the colors black and white mixed together. You see the different values. This is probably like maybe 10 values, maybe 9 values, even more than that. I can't count. But you notice something. So you got your white over to your left, black over to your right. But in the middle, you have your middle gray. Those are your mid value range. Then your lower value range is over there towards your black. And then you got your white value range over towards your left side. So anytime as an artist understands values, in other words, to find out what value range in a grayscale, that's why it's good to do a lot of drawing, help you see colors and stuff really well. Help you squinting helps you find those values, because a lot of times colors can throw you off. Not every color that you see, like greens and blues, just you taking colors out of random, and just know that when you take the saturation out of them, make them down to the grayscale level, they're going to be probably different in value. So it's good to know that. Here is another value, same value scale, but this time I put some white circles along the conjoining value where the two different values meet. So on your far left-hand side is white, on your far right-hand side is black, and in the middle is your middle gray, or your tones, or your middle value range. So anytime you put down paint, it's going to have a value, and depending on the value range of that paint that you put down, it's going to create an edge. Now, the greater the contrast of the value range, is going more than likely, in an abrupt shift and there's no transition, then it's going to create a hard edge. It's going to actually pop out. You'll be able to see the edge. Now, when the values come closer and closer together, then you tend to create it automatically to the eye. It tends to create a soft value. A soft edge. And then when the values are pretty much definitely right at the same value range, there could be two different colors, but right at the same value, then you won't be able to see the edge, and it will be considered a lost edge. Here are two pictures or two photos. The one at the top is lighter in value. The one at the bottom is lower in value. Pretty much is the both pictures are different. They're contrasting in value range all over the image. And if you were to look at the value scale, the range of values, the one at the bottom is considered a lower value or lower key. The one at the top is in a higher value or higher key. So your top image of the cube is considered a higher key. So if you do paintings or any type of imagery or a realism, and it has most of all the value range on average is pretty much a higher value or lighter value, it will be considered a high key painting or tonal painting. Then you have a lower key tonal painting, which would be considered a lower range or darker value, pretty much. And so this, what when you have a majority of your values agreeing with each other, it creates a mood. Here is a painting of a green apple and a blue background. So this painting is done the way it looks. It's done in, looks like the artist probably started out with a paintbrush, but then they switched over to it's possible that they switched over to a palette knife, because you got a lot of deconstruction or destruction or destroyed the form to some extent. The edges are pretty much broken off. So we're going to dissect this painting here. The artist who did this painting, their name is Ingrid Christensen. They are on Instagram. So I put a rectangle on the area where there's a paint marking or a paint brush stroke onto the canvas, and they're close in value. So I'm gonna zoom in, let you see how close they are with your eyes so you can see it. So if you squint your eyes, you can barely tell the separation between the two colors, but because they're close in range, this creates a soft edge. Okay, now here's another edge that I want to share with you guys. This is considered a broken edge. As I'm about to zoom in close, as you can see, that's broken edge, because if you look very carefully, you see the background and the apple itself. There's like color just separated from the apple, just like it's floating out there. It's a creative effect that is more abstract realism. But it really, aesthetically to me personally as an artist, this is my type of preference of type of artwork. Just loose and broken up. I love that painterly style to it. And so this is called a broken edge. Here's another example of a painting by artist Ingrid Christensen. And if you notice, there's a lot of variety of edges that you can see in the picture. And I'm about to zoom in as about right now. So I took the liberty to circle the edges that I could see, and starting from left going to the right in sequence of the circles all the way to the far circle that's furthest to the right, you have first circle on the left side, you have a broken edge. As you can see, the hair, the part of the hair is soft, but it's broken off from the hair. That's more abstract quality, aesthetic appeal. Then the second one going to the right would be considered a hard edge. So you see that you see a hard contrast in values. Move on to the third circle going to the right, you see a lost edge. That is considered a lost edge, as you can't even see the ending of the hair and the face itself, or the jaw. Then you go up to the very top corner, there's considered another lost edge from the background and the hair. You can't even see the difference in the values on that. And then last but not least, that last one going further to the right would be considered a soft edge. You can barely see the edge where the hairline ends and meets with the background. Here's another and final example of a variety of edges by artist Ingrid Christensen. I'm about to zoom in to let you guys see the beautiful way how this artist used a variety of edges, like lost edges and so forth. So starting from the top going all the way down, we have a hard edge from where the bridge of the nose, the angle where the nose and how it connects with the shape of the background, or which we considered in art the negative shape. And so you have a hard edge. Now going down to the shoulder, which would be the subject's left shoulder, we're going from the top going down, second circle, it would be considered a lost edge. You cannot see where the end of the shoulder of the dress versus the background, because they blur out, or you just can't see it because the values are so close in range. So that's considered a lost edge. Then next we have another hard edge between the at the chest or the breast part, between the on the dress and the background, you have a different shift in actual color and in value. So you can see a hard edge plainly on that. Then going down close to the chest and waist, which is the fourth circle down, going down will be considered a lost edge. There's nothing soft about that. It's completely gone. You can't see the demarcation there of value. Then going to the wrist, to the right, but going down, which would be the fifth circle, we have a soft edge again, or actually a soft edge on that. And then at the very bottom circle is considered a soft edge. So the artist did a very great job, in my opinion. I really like the brushwork of this artist and how they use the variety of edges. Here's my last example of how you as an artist can use a variety of edges to effectively make an aesthetic pleasing painting as an artist. So this artist here is considered one of the greatest portrait painters in American history, John Singer Sargent. Now there's a whole lot more great portrait artists in American history, but John Singer Sargent is considered one of the greatest American portrait painters. And so here, and by the way, I want to make this clear, a lot of his paintings were really huge. So now, as again, I've taken the liberty to point out some of the different variety of edge work in his art as well. He too uses a variety of edges, from lost edges to soft edges and hard edges. But it's very aesthetically pleasing because this artist, you don't see a variety or a whole lot of hard edges in his artwork. It's a lot of the brush strokes are just deliberate and direct on purpose. If we were to zoom in, you can see the paint is just applied with almost like as if he really took the time deliberately to think about when he made that mark, and he put the paint down and didn't blend it. He just left it alone. This is impressionistic style type of paint. And so starting from the eye that's far to the left up on his head, that's close to the edge of it, the background in his head, in the shadow, that is considered a lost edge. And then you have his shoulder down there, that's the little small circle down there, that's considered a soft edge at that area. And then you have a hard edge down at the very bottom in the middle, where his lapel and his shirt meets. That's a hard edge. And then going back up toward near the chin or the jaw where the collar meets, that's considered a soft edge. Then the ear is considered a soft edge. And then we have a lost edge with his hair, just the values just being practically almost just the same, where you just can't see the difference. Is completely lost where the edge of his hair and the background meets. Here's a painting that I did back around August of 2017. This is also on my D's Drawings and Paintings blog. I will put the blog down in the description, so you can read up on the article that I did about this painting here. This is a profile of a lady looking to the left, and her hair is in a braid. Now, as you can see, there's not much drama or dramatic or appealing. It looks good, don't get me wrong. I really was pleased and still is pleased with it. However, my journey and my artist journey has changed since then, and now I see, looking back at some of my earlier works, how much I have improved. As you could tell, there's a soft edge, a very soft edge around the jawline where the ear and where the neck, or if you could look real good where the ear is at and going toward the front of the face, there, right around the side of the face, that jaw where the jawline begins, there's a slight shift in value, creating the form, but it's really underdeveloped. There's not the lighting, poor lighting, and as an artist, I could have created that, but at the time, I was limited on my knowledge and how to create these variety of edge. Now, if I was to go back and actually do that painting, which I probably would do, I might just do that, but just thinking about it, I could now, with the knowledge of the variety of different edge works and everything, I can actually enhance this painting a lot more with the knowledge I have now. So it was very fun, as always, to create paintings and drawings and stuff. But this is, I just wanted you guys to share where I was back in my journey, how all these hard edges, a lot of contrast, the white background, there's no, it's just there, you know, it's like a cutout almost. There's no sense of light and there's no sense of shadow. Even though there is a little bit of a value shift. And then another thing I really wasn't pleased about, but I just went on and shared it anyway, is the raccoon effect. I hate to talk about my own artwork, y'all, but it's like the socket, eye socket around the eye socket is way too dark compared to the values of that are in the neck and the chest part. But overall, it's very good. I really was pleased how I effectively did the braiding of the hair. It really looks nice. But as you could tell, now my works have truly improved. I look back and it's been a big change in that. So just wanted to share with you guys that. And also, here's another one of my latest paintings, portrait paintings, which was done just recently. And look at the difference here. Here's the last portrait I've done most recently at the time of this video being recorded. It is a picture of Shaquille O'Neal. I know, hopefully you guys got a chance to watch the most recent one video I made prior to this one being made. But if you just haven't seen it, please go and watch that video of me making this painting. I was really pleased at the development of this painting and really achieved a level of variety of brush marks. And that was my whole purpose of just really, a lot of times when I did those plein air paintings and stuff, it was me trying to loosen up, trying to get really loose and more direct with my brush marks and stuff. So this was I'm very pleased. Lots of variety of edges. You got your hard edge, you got your soft edge. I'm not even gonna break down that, but you could tell I've come a long way, especially there's a more atmosphere quality to it. I even incorporated broken edge, which now is gonna be I'm gonna make it one of my new styles. It's that impressionistic, broken color, broken edges, almost still realism, and in some ways just really had a lot of fun doing this, and I just was really pleased at the results. And that's it about edges, you guys. I hope this has been a blessing to you, and I hope you be able to use these edges to your advantage the next time you get out and paint. So God bless you. Remember to subscribe to my channel, hit the notification bell, and you can also follow me on Instagram and Facebook at the letter D Weaver Art. Thank you for watching. God bless you, and see you next time.